Gut, then regarding programming, then today I would like to discuss Python data structures. How do I do this? And I will do this by writing a script. So I don't know whether you need to zoom in on your screen. So that you can better read what I'm writing, but I think I will do everything that I'm doing today in Spider, not on PowerPoint, because we don't need any fancy figures. And what I'm doing today is also fairly conventional. So maybe the last two sessions for those who had taken Python courses before, maybe there was some new stuff in there, for example, with respect to shared references and so on, where we went more into the theory behind things. Today is definitely more hands-on, if you want, because we want to talk about tuples, lists, and dictionaries. And if you worked with Python, you will already have encountered them. In Python, as you will also have figured by now, the data structure that is used mainly for numerical computing is the ND array object from NumPy. And for example, if I would give an introduction to MATLAB, we would start also with this array object, because that's where we can put numbers, where we can compute averages over numbers, or yeah, sum numbers, multiply numbers, and so on. And this is, after all we want to do in data analysis. In Python, because it's a more general programming language, such a data container for numerical data that can easily be used, maybe even as a matrix, as a mathematical matrix, or as a mathematical vector, is not built into the Python language, but is only based, as I said, on this additional package, namely NumPy. So the ideally, or if one wanted to focus just on numerical programming, one could say, okay, yeah, there are some Python data structures, that's nice, but we have the ND array, so let's just work with the ND array and let's not care about Python data structures. Unfortunately, actually, that doesn't quite work. Actually, that was a little bit my hope, because then from switching from MATLAB to Python, there would have been less to learn. It doesn't quite work because, of course, the ND array object, which we will discuss when we talk about numerical computing in Python and NumPy, builds on the data structures that are in Python, and also some of the conventions that come with the data structures in Python carry over to the ND array object. So there's no way around looking into Python data structures. I think there are some conventions on Python data structures, so that I think the general convention is, if you could use a Python data structure instead of something else that comes from a package, you should use the Python data structure. I think that's what people say. So you should first work with what you have, and then if it's really well justified to use something, a more specific data structure from some package for certain applications, yes, then of course you can also do that. But yeah, you shouldn't unnecessarily multiply the zoology of data structures that you use for organizing data. Yeah, so that's essentially what I wanted to say to embed this whole session, and then the rest now will be to talk about three data structures in some depth, but also not that much depth, namely tuples, lists, and dictionaries. There are also sets, which we will not talk about. They are mainly used if you actually do want to use set operations. And of course, we will also not completely cover all the things that you can do with tuples, lists, and dictionaries. So I'm just focusing on certain aspects in the creation, indexing, manipulation of these objects. I will talk a little bit about slicing and the conventions there, and I will talk a little bit about in-place changes and shared references. And then I think I talked a little bit about some basic aspects of the Python data structures that suffices to then talk about the ND array object in the second after next session, and also to talk about control flow in the next session. Because also to introduce control flow without ever having created some kind of data object also doesn't quite work. So today fairly conventional. If you don't like me hearing about it, just type into YouTube Python tuples and you will find another online tutorial that will tell you similar stuff. Good, let's get started. Tuples, creation and indexing. So the first thing with data structures, which are data containers where you can store data and then carry operations on, carry out operations on. The first thing with these data structures is that you always need to create them and somehow get them into existence. And most of the time, or usually you can, or the easiest way to do that is actually by means of an assignment. And the assignments for different data structures look slightly, or the creation assignments for different data structures look slightly different. For a tuple, you create a tuple, which I call T1 here, by putting or writing up an assignment where on the right side of the assignment statement you put things separated by a comma. Yeah? And then T1 is a tuple. So if I'm writing everything here in a wait, I could make it a little bit bigger, sorry. If I'm writing everything here, then so that's a little better. Then I need to print everything so that I see what's happening in the command window. First, I need to save this. And as you can see, if I now print T1, so this name T1, as we learned, I see this, and if I print the type of T1, I see that this is from the class or the data structure type tuple. Yeah, so we've now created a tuple by this assignment. The tuples can also be created by an assignment with brackets. So if I put brackets around this, and sorry, I need to say the right word, because there are parentheses and brackets, and I think these are called parentheses or brackets. So if you use the round version, you create a tuple. If you use the square version, you use create a list, as we will see later. So that doesn't change anything, but it's not necessary, yeah. So in a way, I would almost recommend not using brackets in this case, because then it's even clearer that you are creating a tuple here. The tuple has a specific length, which you can always look up with the len function, and obviously here the length is 3, as you see here. Now, tuples are a very, in my opinion, low-key data structure, so you cannot really do much. So people join and then leave. You cannot really do much with tuples, which is in a way also a little bit the idea of tuples. So tuples are what they refer to. First of all, they are one-dimensional, so if you you can only index them in one dimension. We will see indexing in a second, but you, it's not like a square array or a matrix or a higher dimensional array or something. It's just a one-dimensional entity. They are fixed length, so you cannot, once you created a tuple, you cannot change the length of that. That's always fixed, and it's immutable. And immutable means that it cannot be mutated. That's how I think about it, meaning that you cannot reassign things. So once this tuple is created, it's there, it's fixed length, and you cannot change it, essentially. This is specific to this tuple data type, and I think it's a little bit clearer if we then see also mutable data structures. What one can do is obviously store data in a tuple, and here in tuple 1 we stored the numbers 5, 6, 7. You can also for example store different data types in this. This is for example difference to numeric arrays, where you can only store numbers in. In tuples, you can also store strings or booleans. So if you print this, you see that it's a tuple, and this tuple now has a string, a number, and a boolean. So it's flexible in this regard. And then, of course, you can access data inside a tuple by indexing it. So, for example, if you want the first entry of the tuple t1, so let's call this t1 0, and now, of course, what you should always keep in mind is the Python starts counting at 0, so in a way I shouldn't call it the first entry, but the 0th entry. You would index the tuple, and this time, and indexing in Python obviously always with square brackets, and the first thing would be the thing that's at the 0 index. So for t1 0, that would be 5. So if we print this, we see here the 5. If we print the first entry, or the 0 index entry of tuple t2, then we see that this is the A that we put there. So that's possible. You know that in Python you can also index with negative indices. So maybe I already show you that now. So if we let's do a tuple T3, which has the no, that's not a tuple. That's a list. If we create a tuple like this, I need a little bit more than just 3, so hence the thing here. then these two indices in the positive and in the negative way in Python work as follows. So the first obviously is 0, and then we go up. That's not surprising, because we indexing starts at indexing starts at 0. Somehow we want to do it. How we do it? So we have something of length 6, and the largest index is 5. Now the negative indices, they start. Wait a second.
With -1.
Yeah, they start with -1, but I wanted to figure out something else. Yeah, but we can also start with -1. In any case, then if you start with -1, then in the end we are at the 3 minus 6, I would assume. No, minus 5. Minus is, that's of course completely wrong, that's why I didn't get what I wanted. So I'm quite happy. Yeah, and this is why I'm confused, sorry. So they start with -1. But because somebody said they start with -1, I was now in the mood to start with -1. But they shouldn't start with -1, I should start with -6. Because if you go in the normal order, it starts with the negative of the length. Because essentially ends with -1, or starts if you go in the backwards way. So this is what I wanted to show you, and these are the positive and negative indices, and always we'll get to this why somewhat sensible. Somewhat sensible it is, but it's somewhat sensible. So that's essentially indexing for tuples. And this immutability relates to the thing that can be assigned things. So for example, we have T3, and say, okay, T3 at location 2, instead of kind of also an inbuilt feature of them, so they remain static, and you cannot, once they are created, maybe as outputs of a function or so on, they stay like that, and you cannot erroneously reassign them to something. Two things that are also interesting in terms of creation is nested tuples. So you can create tuples. So you can create, for example, a tuple that contains a tuple 1, 2, 3, a tuple A and B, and a tuple true and false. And here you see why this these round brackets make some sense, because this now creates tuples on the right hand side. So this is a tuple, this is a tuple, and this is a tuple. Now we could make brackets all around it to create the tuple. Well, or we can leave it like that, which creates a nested tuple. And for example, if you deal with MATLAB code and you want to translate MATLAB code, for example, cell arrays into Python, then actually lists or not tuples necessarily, but these kind of nested things are helpful. So this is a nested tuple. So you can, and the point is just that you can create tuples of tuples. This still gives an error, so we could also put an exception there, but I just comment it out. We have that, and one thing that is also interesting is the creation of single entry tuples, or two things. Zero item tuples, so if you want to create an empty tuple, you can just use the brackets, but then T4 is a tuple. So let me go here. Otherwise it wouldn't be a tuple if you didn't put the brackets. So here you have the empty tuple, but it's a tuple. So it's a tuple. And if you want to create a tuple one item, then of course if you just would do this, it would just be a numeric variable. So this would just create also, I didn't print it, sorry. So now T5 is an integer, but you can render a tuple by using a trailing comma. So now T5 is also a tuple. So sometimes you want to initialize things as something, or you need to something that you need to pass somewhere needs to be a tuple and cannot be an integer. So then to make sure that it's a tuple, which then of course can be indexed, so you can do things like T5 0. So if you have some code that wants to index things, then you can create something that is a tuple by this trailing comma. Yo. So that's basic tuple creation and indexing. One can concatenate tuples, so in terms of manipulation, one can concatenate them. Concatenation. So for example, if we do T6 equals T3 plus T4, then we put together the tuples 3 and 4. Did we? No, T3. T4 was the empty one, that was not that helpful. So, but as you see, it was also concatenated there as an empty thing. And here we now included this other tuple which just had the 4. Let's concatenate maybe something more interesting. Oh, they are both T3, but that also doesn't matter. Let's concatenate with a T1. So that's something more exciting happens, and you see that this 5, 6, 7 also in there. So plus, as we discussed last time, plus not only means addition in Python, but also can be used to for concatenation, which you might also know from strings. The same thing applies to reproduction or concatenating n times. Concatenating n times maybe. Concatenating n times. So that would be, for example, 7 times t1, which would give us a tuple that contains t1 7 times, as we see here. Or basically, it's a concatenation. It doesn't contain them, but it's a concatenation, a tuple that has the entries of t1 7 times after one another. So that's basically what I wanted to say about tuples. You often, or one occasion where you always see tuples is if you, as outputs of functions. We will see that if we, for example, write for loops and use some enumerate function, then this usually returns indices and values, and they are always returned as tuples. So if you write for loops in Python and you want to have access to both the running index and the data, you will come across tuples. Besides that, so for data analysis, for example, what you can use tuples for is to contain definitions of things. So, for example, when we do our agent-based behavioral modeling, then in the language of that we also have tuples, and which are just definitions, things that remain constant throughout everything, which you don't want to work with essentially. You just want to define and look up, so essentially a little bit like a table that you don't want to compute with or something. There they are useful and also make sense in kind of the mathematical sense of the word. But for example, if you want to analyze brain imaging data and you have voxel activation values for many voxels, you don't want to put them into a tuple because you will not really be able to do much with that. Yeah. Any other suggestions of what to do with tuples besides that they are there, come out of functions, and that you can use for things that you want to keep constant?
Sometimes if you need to put if you need to put like a number as a dictionary entry maybe, then you can use a tuple instead, because it's because normally you wouldn't be allowed to have like an integer, for instance, as a key in a dictionary. But if you want to have, for some reason, indices or whatever, then you can use a tuple because it's a data type that you can use as a key.
That's definitely a point. So and this also relates to the fact that in a way you can't really get around these data structures in Python, because once you, for example, you think dictionaries are a good idea, then you see that you also need to know a little bit about what a tuple is, because otherwise this, what you just explained, wouldn't make that much sense. Okay, tuples, creation and indexing and manipulation. So of course there's more to tuples that you can read about. Manipulation, but I think I want to leave it here also with a little bit on the focus of what you can use these data structures for, not basically being exhaustive with respect to what you can do with them, because this is also something that you, when you program, you will look up again and again. Good, then next up are lists. And again, creation, indexing, and manipulation a little bit. And lists, now for those who have done some programming, from my taste, are most closely are most similar to cell arrays, where you can store different kinds of data. You can replace things, but in contrast to cell arrays, they're actually one-dimensional. So again, lists are one-dimensional variable length, so you can increase the length of a list once it's created, or remove things. So the length of a list is a variable, and they are mutable, and they are sequences of Python objects. Python objects of objects. So you can store any kind of objects in tuples, but also in lists. With lists, you have a little bit more flexibility in terms that you can work with these data structures, remove things, reassign certain slots. But again, in a way, this is then also where it ends a little bit. So for numerical computing, they are not quite, I think, what you want. But for data organization, if you think in terms of databases, for example, if you want, if you have a database and you are happy with indexing this database just based on numbers and not based on keywords, as you would, as you can do with dictionaries, but you are happy to index just with numbers, which sometimes makes things actually easier than to index with keys, then lists are a thing to use. So lists are created using square brackets and can contain different kinds of data. So here in this list L1, I would just include numeric data, but likewise you can create a list that contains numeric data and string data and Boolean data or some kind of object that you have created. So they are flexible in terms of the data they contain. Indexing, so this linear indexing that we've seen for tuples works the same way. So for example, if we want the third argument of L2, and assign that somewhere, that's the MATLAB speaking, then we get it by square brackets. Obviously also you need the square brackets to define a list, because if you would not use the square brackets to define a list, you would get a tuple. I'm not really clear whether it would be better if a tuple would always go with a round bracket, whether that wouldn't be better. But you can do both with tuples, either no brackets or round brackets. In any case, if you use square brackets, you create a list. Let's just confirm this also. So print type L2, that this is not a tuple, but a list. That's what you see here. Negative indices and the whole indexing business in terms of counting works as previously. And yeah, you can also check whether some object of interest is in a list. So for example, if you inquire true in L2, so using this in keyword, then you get true as an answer, because true is in the list. So basically this in operator here searches through the entire list and searches whether this thing is in this. So for example, for 6 in L2 we also get true, but for example for B in L2 we would get a false, because there's obviously no B in L2. Now in terms of manipulation, one can do reassignments, so that's possible. So if we have L2 as defined there, so let's briefly print L2 again and now reassign something. So we, for example, reassign, want to change the 6 here to the B that I promised. So 6 is at the linear index 1, so we say L2 with these square brackets at 1, and assign B there, and then print L2 again. We will see that first L2 was A6 true, and now it's AB true. And again, this is not possible for tuples, so you cannot reassign entries in tuples, which is the same as saying they are immutable. Here you can reassign entries or slots to different content, and this is what is called mutable. There are a number of list functions. So one thing that you can do is, because they are also variable length, you can grow lists. So this you can do using the append function. So if you so of course L2, like everything in Python, is an object, so it has methods which you can invoke using this dot notation, as we discussed in the beginning or a couple of lectures ago. And then you can now grow the list of L2. So let me show you that. So you can use len for L2, but we can also directly print L2 and compare to what we see above. So now the list has been extended or grown by one element. This can sometimes be useful in for loops when you collect things and you want to grow your data structure. In general, I have to say, like with many things, I'm not the biggest fan of growing data structures. I think it's cleaner code if you, before you grow data structures, that you initialize a data structure at the size, at the exact size that you actually require. For example, if you want to put 100 things into a list, for example, there are also these list comprehensions that do that explicitly. If you want to do that, yes, you can write a for loop and append and append and append. But it can also be that then something goes wrong, for example, because you don't do as many iterations as you wanted to, or something like that. Or that certain things in your for loop are then not defined, and you append non-numbers or something like that. So in general, growing things dynamically during code execution, also, I mean, this is also a MATLAB carryover, because that usually then always needs to look for a new space in working memory, is not the best practice. At least that's how I came out of 15 years of MATLAB. So in general, it would make sense to initialize the objects that you're dealing with. However, I'm also not 100% sure of how easy that is with lists. But again, for numeric data, I also wouldn't use lists necessarily, because for that we have the ND array. You can insert, so there are a couple of more functions which I will now not explain. So you can insert at specific locations. So for example, if you do to insert to true, then you insert true at the location that you chose, which is the second location, and then everything else gets shifted. You can remove entries using the pop method. So for example, remove this, or add multiple things. So append always adds only one, but you can also add multiple using the extend method. And you can remove things using L2 or list remove function. So you can manipulate the length and the entries of a list. That's the basic point here. So I think I think before, so there are two things that, so a little bit more on slicing and shared references and in-place changes that I want to go over, but I think that would be good after a break. Before the break, I then would like to briefly introduce you to dictionaries, which are, in terms of a data structure, a general data structure, very useful and very explicit. They are helpful. So I really encourage use indexing. Maybe you would even like to use structures, as I will show you in a second. So dictionaries are key value variable size collections of key value pairs. So the nice thing about dictionaries as opposed to lists is that for lists you always need to kind of be clear on the mapping from your linear index to a specific content. So for example, if you have the convention that always at the third or the second linear index of this list you have a boolean, and then you can of course always work with the linear index 2. But if you want to be more explicit and easier to read with your code, you could also in a dictionary give this entry a specific name. For example, the boolean in the dictionary, and then look that up explicitly by referring to the boolean. So dictionaries are created with curly brackets, which now convinces me that tuples should be created with round brackets, because then tuples would have round brackets, lists would have square brackets, and dictionaries have curly brackets. Then at least this would be coherent. So that there are no that this works. Somebody give me a good reason why this works and the whole thing is still coherent. In any case, dictionaries you create with curly brackets, and then you define the keys with strings, usually, because you would like to have things that are meaningful. Of course, A is more or less meaningful, but you could call this, I don't know, if you have a circle, you could call this the radius, any features of the thing that you're trying to encode, you can give meaningful names. And then, so these are the keys, and then you can have another key where you, for example, store booleans. And you can have another key where you store maybe another list. And this gives you a dictionary. This is called dictionary with invalid syntax. What did I do wrong?
Equal after C, yeah.
So extent, these are these things, sorry. I have the different shortcut on this computer. So now we have our dictionary, and we can look up things in the dictionary using key-based indexing. So for example, if we are interested in what the value of the dictionary with of this dictionary with key B is, we just put into square brackets this B. And as far as I remember, let me check. No, that doesn't work. So these are dictionaries, so they are helpful because you can be explicit. One thing that, especially for those people who have done MATLAB, This dictionary style is still a little bit of overkill. And in MATLAB, there's this very nice data structure called a structure, which is basically like an object with named attributes that can store data. And what I'm now always doing in my code is that I emulate this structure type in MATLAB. Let me show you how this looks, because that doesn't exist in Python, but it's really, really helpful because it requires less syntactical overhead than dictionaries, but has the same kind of nice properties that you have this name-based or key-based or yeah, let's say name-based indexing. So what I'm always using this is when I pass multiple arguments to a function, I always use a structure so that I don't have many input arguments, and then you can work with the parts of the structure by explicitly naming them. So what I would usually then do is call PyStructure. Somebody I think also already saw that in some code of mine, which calls this class definition file, but it's a very simple class that basically doesn't do much. Of course I need to import it. Oh. 1 week of MATLAB programming and I forget everything from good. So S is now the structure, and what you can do with S is that you can store, for example, parameter values here. So if this, I don't know, describes some geometric object, then instead of using a list where you have a linear index, or a dictionary where you have a little bit of a syntactic overhead in terms of this curly brackets here, you can just do a dot based assignment, and then you can look up what you have in there using this dictionary. So let's see whether that does something. Nope. But we can print this, of course. So here you then see the content of S. And it's actually a dictionary, but the assignment stuff is a little bit easier, and you can do this not dot notation. Of course, this is just a Python. This is just a Python object that is self-defined in terms of its class structure. But really, for me, for coming from MATLAB and really loving structures because they are so easy, very explicit, and really, really helpful, I needed something that I can use for that. And dictionaries, yes, they try to fulfill the same purpose, but they're a little bit messier. So I use this structure emulation. Good. Then I would suggest we take a break. And after the break, look a little bit more into advanced indexing and in-place changes. Any questions?
Can't you do the same thing that you do with the class, but just have like S and then the square and then the indices to a new key and then assign it to a value? Isn't that kind of the same thing?
You mean something like start a new one, so let's call it U and do B. You mean this? Do you mean this?
Yeah, but I mean after you defined the U already, obviously. Once you defined U as a dictionary and then.
And how should I do this? As an empty dictionary or?
I think you could just do u equals, yeah, curly brackets, and then I think that should work.
I also think that should work. Yes. You can do it like this, but you get around having this and square brackets. You only have a dot. Okay, it's a minor thing, but I think that I had another reason why I like the structure thing a little bit more than dictionaries. But I don't remember right now. There was something else. But yes, definitely. So the logic is very much the same. I think there was something why I also preferred these structures over dictionaries, but now I don't remember. But you're right. You can also write like this. Good, anything else? Good, then let's stop here and start like in 10 minutes again. Good, so in the last hour then today, I would like to talk a little bit about slicing and a little bit about in-place changes. So slicing, again, if you're coming from MATLAB, it refers to the colon operator. That's how you call that in MATLAB. I think actually called slicing is a little bit more sensible. So 1 point for Python. That's a rare occurrence in my world. Slicing refers to extracting multiple slots of sequence-like data types. So we've seen tuples and we've seen lists, and we've seen that we index them or we can index them using integers, so what is also called as linear indexing. But what we've seen so far is that we have, for example, a list, and let's create a list here, 4, 6, 9, 13, 18. So we have a list, and what we've done so far is that we just look at a single or extracted a single element, so the data at a given slot. So for example, if we looked at index 3, which would be the fourth position, so 0, 1, 2, 3, we don't want to actually assign something, we want to extract it, so let's extract it. Then can print this. We extract some data at this position, namely 13, but we only extract a single element. And often, of course, we want to extract not a single element, but multiple elements. And to this, Python provides the slicing operator, and that takes the following form. You give it a start index, then you give it a colon operator, and you give it a stop index. And this refers to slots from start, which is an integer, to stop minus 1. Yeah, so that's also something to get used to. There is one reason for that, which I will show you in the end. Maybe you already know what the reason for this is, but that's how that works. So for example, if you want the first three elements in L in this list here, 4, 6, 9, at once, you would need to do something like this. Oops, slice, maybe I shouldn't use this. Didn't know that does something. L slice. You would say L, and then you would start at 0, and if you want the first three ones, you need to go to 4, because then you get everything from the start to stop minus 1. That's a little bit something to get used to, that your stop index always needs to be sorry, I confused myself again. 4, 6, 9, 13. No, that's fine. But I wanted the first three ones. So again. So I want the first three entries here, and they have the numbers. So I confused a lot of things here. I want the first three entries, and they have the indices. Let's write the indices above them. They have the indices 0, 1, and 2. Now, if I want these first entries with indices 0, 1, and 2, I need the start to be 0 and the stop to be 2 plus 1, so 3, because it always runs from start to stop minus 1. Yeah? So I think I skipped everything by one number and also didn't and started to count from 1. Yeah, but so it would be, at least coming from MATLAB, it would be a little bit more natural to do this, because then there the 2 would be included. Here the 2 is only included if the stop index in the slicing operator is 1 plus, is the last thing that you want to extract, plus 1. That's the logic. The good thing about this, though, is that the length of what you extract is always, and this is how, of course, one thing that this makes sense, length of slice is always the stop minus start. Yeah. So if you, in MATLAB, you sometimes wonder, so if I put 0, 2, so how long will that be? And you don't see 3 anywhere, and then essentially you need to count, okay, how many numbers are there? In Python, based on the slicing thing, you always see it from the stop and start, from the start and stop indices, because you can always compute it as stop minus start. So for example, if we now take another slice and just make something up, L1, 2, 5, well, 5, is there a fifth actually? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, no, 1, 2, 4, then without thinking, you already know that the length of this will be 4 minus 1, so 2, so 3. Or in this case, you will know that it's 4 minus 2, so 2. And that's in a way helpful, I think, and also somewhat logical. You just always need to be aware that you need to increase your stop index by 1 to get the last one that you want. Now the one of the principal reasons why they think that's really cool is that there is some default behavior, namely if you you can omit the start or the stop indices. So let me show you that. So if we do L1 to be the list from 0 to this element here, the 9, instead of starting with 0, you can just put the colon operator and get this. So this is the same as saying 0 to 3, and the same applies to the stop operator. So you can, or stop index. So if you start at 4 and don't specify a stop, it will go to the very end. I think that should work, doesn't it? So it starts at 4, so 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and to the end, so that's just this single element. And now the beauty, if you want, of this is that Because it doesn't include, if you use L1 and use, for example, 3 as your stop index, because it doesn't include this, then if you start L2 at 3 and you add them together, then you always get the original list. So let L3 be, or you, I mean, by adding together, I mean to concatenate. So if you do this, you get again the original list. So basically, this way of using the slicing operators ensures that whatever you choose for I, you always have, if you have a list or some sequence-like object, you always have that this thing holds. Yeah. So starting with the starting from 0 and up to I, which means one less than I, and starting from I going to the end always gives you the object. And that's yeah, that's and that holds for all I. It's beautiful. Yeah, one thing, so that's in a way kind of a reason why the logic with from start to stop minus one and from then with this default behavior, that you can always ensure this. So this is why they love it. For all I, but I needs to be len for all I in 0 to len L minus 1, because the largest index that you have is the length minus 1, and that's again a little bit confusing, I find. So if you print L3, you have length 5, but your largest index is 4, which is of course due to the fact that you start at 0 and not at 1. Yeah. One thing that is not completely unimportant and where you can easily get errors is that slicing and indexing return different things, which is also something that you can actually see here. So when we print these things, we always get a list back. Now if you have a list, for example the list, oops, where am I? So let's call this slicing versus indexing. This is how I got many errors, or many bugs, not really bugs, but errors where the code stopped executing. If you have a list and for example you want to extract the data at the first entry, which has the index 0 obviously, then you would do this and have an integer object or an integer object. So this gives you an this here is an integer, and of course now we might also print this. Of course, this is element. So it's the integer 1 and it's an integer. Now if you slice this, now if you do l slice, or you could also call it list, so you address exactly the same slot, which you can do for example by going from 0 to 1, where of course the stop is, this is also, I don't know, is it confusing, is it not confusing, of course it stops already at 0 because it stops at 1 at 1 minus 1. You can also write this of course by defaulting to the 0 just as this. Then you get back as a data structure a list, and this list of course contains the zero. So here you see that what you get back from slicing, just by basically using a little bit of a different indexing notation here, you get back a different class. So you don't get back the content of this, but you get the list which has at this location a list. And this also applies to the all the slicing. Yeah? So you always extract lists, which feels kind of natural if you do multiple entries, because how else should it come back? If they would not be somehow bound together in a list, then it would also be weird. But if you extract a single element, which sometimes you do in code, you need to be careful whether you want to actually have the element as the data type that it's actually representing, or you want the list with a single entry. Yeah? It's just something to be aware of, because for example a list you can then index again, whereas an element of course you cannot index again. So if we have L element, this indexing this does not work, but if we have S ls slice 0, then we can access the content. So that's something to look out for. Good. Then one can also do negative indexing. But I think I will skip that. So if you want to play around with negative indexing and slices, do that. One can. It's a nice way to always confuse oneself a little bit, but one can do that. What I want to skip to here is then multi-step indexing, because that's something you also need sometimes. And maybe also reverse slicing. So multi-step indexing uses the advanced slicing operator, which comes with an explicit step size. So oops. And there it's always the question, what will be the last element that you get? And as far as I figured it out, it's it generates the indices start, of course, then start plus 1 times step, and so on. So start plus 2 times step, up to start plus e times step, while, so it does this, but it stops at one point, because what needs to be fulfilled is that start plus I times step is truly smaller than stop. So these are the indices generated. from my personal experience, it also, but in MATLAB or in Python, it makes sense to check that. So if you write code and you use multi-step indexing, you're not quite sure, is my last element now in there? How many elements do I have? And so on. Just check it. When you write the code, use multi-step indexing, of course, but yeah, in a way, check what's going on. So an example would be the following. So let's again use our Python thing here. Sorry. So this we can now, for example, use with this multi-slice technique to return a list that takes only every other entry. And for example, we can start at 0 and have a step size of 2 and have as the stop integer 4, then we get actually only P and T, because 0 so our start thing here, 0. So we get the 0, 1, and then we get 0 plus 1 times 2, which is 2. So this still applies, but then as the next thing, we get 0 plus 2 times 2, which is 4. And this is already not strictly smaller than the stop anymore. So we only get the 0 index and the second index, so P and T. If we increase the stop index, then we also get the thing at index 4 with it. So because so we get also get the O, so we get P, T, and O, because 2 times 2 is strictly smaller than 5, but it's actually equal to 4, so we get it with it. So this stops here really at a strict inequality. To get, yeah, so there's also a shortcut for this. So if you don't want to specify explicitly with your start and your stop, you can just specify a step size. So if you want every other element, so for example every second element, you can skip the start and the stop, then it starts at 0 and goes until the end, and takes every second one, which yeah, in this case is actually the same as going 0 to 5. Good. One can, and this is sometimes helpful, one can use negative step indices. That's sometimes useful if you want to swap around the order of the entries in the list, or because the same applies to arrays, in arrays. So reverse indexing with the slice operator then works as follows. So if we want to invert the order of L, we can, and let's say we want to invert everything, so we use the colons, and then to go into negative, in the negative direction, um, Wait. Yeah, that's correct. We can use negative step sizes. So now we have inverted the order of the list. So that's sometimes useful. In general, my experience from programming is don't try to be too creative with indexing. It's easy to get errors in there, and because, for example, the strict equality or not strict inequality and so on, you might sometimes not be aware of. So I try to really keep indexing simple, and only if it's really necessary in a certain situation to use something more advanced of indexing, I actually do it. But then I also check it a lot, because I, just from past experience, I know that it's quite easy to get errors, not so much with that. Yeah, mainly with respect to how many things you actually now return, and that this always works and is kind of stable. So yeah, in a way I try to not make my indexing business too complicated, so that I don't understand myself anymore, stay with the simple stuff. And sometimes it's necessary to invert arrays or to yeah, take every second argument. But then it's of course pays, for example, if you take every second argument, then it pays if that the code that you're using this for always only applies to lists that have a length corresponding to an even number or an odd number, so that you always are sure what you get. Because if you sometimes have even or odd numbered sequences, then it of course changes a little bit of how many things you extract. Good, that's what I wanted to say to slicing. There's more stuff about slicing. Obviously, there's a lot more stuff to slicing. We will come back to slicing when we talk about the ND array object. But now, as a final thing for today, I would like to point out this notion of in-place changes, because that's also something one needs to attend a little bit to. And this relates to what we've also seen previously, namely shared references and shared references. And we now relate this also with in-place changes. So we talked about shared references before. So shared references, we also made this little drawing. Shared references occur when you assign a name to a new name, essentially. So remember what's happening here. So first this object here, this list with 2, 3, and 4 is created, then this name L1 is created, and then L1 is set to reference this object in working memory. Yeah, so remember that this is just the name, this is the actual object in working memory, and this assignment state meant essentially creates the pointer from the name to the object. And then we've seen what happens if you write code like this. L2 in this case then also points to L1. And now if we for example now for example look at the second thing in L2, so the 3 here, yeah, we see that this is the 3. I mean, we can also print L2 and see that it's exactly the same as L1. It's just a shared reference to the underlying object. So that's L1, that's L2, and that's L2 1. Now, of course, you can reassign things in lists. So you can do, for example, L2 1 Let's say 300. And then, of course, at L1, 1, as we saw previously, you will now have the value 300. The question is what happens with L2, 1. And as you can see here, this is L1, 1, and this is L2, 1. And this is something one needs to be aware of, because in the code that happened after L2 was actually defined as a shared reference to this thing, nothing was done to L2. Yeah, so there's nothing that somehow changed L2. But what was done was that the object that L1 refers to was changed in place, or you can also think in working memory. So there's this object that L1 points to, and this object by this code here had been modified. And hence, if you then look at L2, then L2 is also, as you also see here, is also modified. So maybe I should maybe make this a little bit more explicit by doing this. So here L1 is 234, that's printed here. Then L2 is set to L1. This is printed here, and both of them have a 3. Now I only change here what's happening in L1. Yeah, but because this is an in-place change at the level of the object, and L2 points to the same object which has now changed, what I get at L2 at location 1 has also changed. And this might, so depending on where you're coming from, might be a little bit to get used to. So for example, in MATLAB, where I'm coming from, because I'm old, but MATLAB is really good, this would have created a copy here. So in this case, L2 would be the same as L1, but it would have its own working memory assignment. And if I change something in L1, this would not affect at all what's happening with L2. And however, it also would need more working memory, because L2 now refers to its own objects, and there are two objects in working memory. In Python, there's one object in working memory, which is this list object, and L1 is a reference to it, L2 is a reference to it. If I change something via reference to or via the reference L1, this also affects, if I then look up with the reference L2, what the object holds. Yeah. One thing that one can do if one wants to avoid this, actually, if you want to avoid this and be able to independently reassign or work with L1 and L2, what you can do is to, instead of just doing this shared reference here, to copy the entire list by extracting it fully. So have a look here. So if I do this, then instead of just writing L1, but put this slice operator here, then L2 is its own list. I change so L2 is its own list in the sense that here a new object in working memory is created, and L2 points to it. Here I change something in place on the object that L1 represents, but the object that L2 points to is not affected. And then you see that if you print this again, L2 still is of the form 234, and at its index 1 it still has a 3. Yeah. So if you want a copy, so this is, in a way, that's the message here. If you want a copy in working memory, you should use slicing. If you want a shared reference, and be okay with the fact that if you change something via one reference, it also shows up if you use the other reference, then you should can use this. But it's something to be aware of. Yeah. So, and of course, it's once if you understood this thing about references and objects that we did last time, then it's not that surprising, but still, yeah, it needs a little bit of an attention to detail here. Good, so that's all I wanted to do today. So, a basic introduction to the data structures in Python, and a little bit on slicing, and a little bit on these shared references and in-place changes. This, I think, is enough to then look at something that's maybe a little bit more interesting next time, namely control flow, which then actually really gets more into programming. This is mainly some infrastructure that is good to know about and that you can't do without, but also something that, yeah, it's important. It's just there. It's just not much is happening. You just learn about the data structures, which of course, maybe that's the last point. These data structures, they will of course, the way these works is not wasn't given by God to Moses on Mount Sinai, and then has been there and has been there from the beginning of time and will be until the end of time. This is not, this is all man-made, right? So people thought about, okay, let's set up a data structure and set up some rules how this data structure works. Of course, in the long run, you want to invent your own data structures, which is this whole thing about object-oriented programming. So you can create data structures, for example, that I showed you with this Python structure that work in different ways. Yeah, here it's just these are the data structures that Guido von Rossum and the Python developers early on thought were a good idea and are generally useful, and we basically have to say, okay, that's what they decided, so we follow their conventions. We also don't have to this is why I sometimes say it's not necessarily helpful to do inference on data structures, in the sense that you try to that you come up you create these own rules in your head how this should work, and then you are kind of frustrated that it doesn't work the way you thought it would work. The thing is, just look up how it works. That's how they defined it, and they, if you want it to work different, then obviously you come up with a thing yourself. But the rules are already set out, and instead of trying to infer the rules from behavior, which you can do in science and should do in science, so to infer the rules of a programming language by observing what it does. Just look up the rules. Yeah, just look into the documentation, and then accept the documentation. And if you really hate it, how things work in a given programming language, invent your own. Good. Any questions?
I have a couple, I guess, comments. Maybe. So it might be kind of pedantic, but I think that in this like L2 equals L1 thing, that applies to any operation on L1 as far as I know. So not just slicing, but also if you were to just say like list L1, then it also wouldn't create, it would create a copy rather than calling back to L1. And then this would be another way to do it. So basically I think any operation does that. And then also with slicing, I'm pretty sure that what the end operator is doesn't matter. So if you had, for example, L:7, even though your list is fewer than 6 elements long, you would still actually only get the first 6.
Yeah, that's so it doesn't matter if it's larger than the oops, where is this?
That index,
if it's larger than the largest index, that's true. But it matters in the sense that, as we saw here, if it's within the length of the thing, then it definitely makes a difference. So,
yeah,
and yeah, but so also see when where am I? No, there. Yeah, so it doesn't matter. Yeah, which is, I don't know what you think about this. I think from my perspective, it should issue an error or turn around or something, but.
I think that it makes it just more compatible with lists of varying length. So, for example, if you know that your longest list is 13 long or whatever, then I don't know. Or like you only ever wanted to take the first 13 things. But my point was above when you make this definition of L equals what was it like colon I to I colon whatever above. And it's not only while I is less than the length or whatever, but rather always. Because if you also were to make a slice of L, yeah, like six, you would just get an empty list if you index above, basically. Or not index, but slice above. Where's the why they love it or whatever? That was where you wrote something.
This
Yeah,
thing.
here. Yeah, it's not just for all I in that length. I think it's just for all I.
Ah, okay. Yeah, it's true. For all I in the natural numbers, then I would. Does that?
Yeah,
No, but does it?
for all integers, basically.
Does it? But that's also
I.
that's a little bit weird because let's check that because that would mean that you can say, oh, that's actually wrong here, right? It should be this.
You were to do L colon 70 or something, I think you just get an empty list.
Let's have a look. So we have L1, and now you're saying L1. So this is what we just discussed, basically. So that the start, if the stop, if you go beyond that, that it doesn't matter. And now you're saying that if you start at something too large, you can empty list down.
Yeah, then you get an empty list.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is really this flexibility in Python that obviously I'm not used to from MATLAB, and yeah, it makes it flexible. It in a sense that you get around code crashes. So, but yeah. Yeah, that's the flexibility. This is why people love Python, because you can write nonsensical code and it still works. That's what I would say. Because or but at least you would get an at least you should get an error if you do this, yeah.
Yeah, of course, yeah. With indexing, it doesn't work. It's only
No.
with slicing.
No. Anything else on the flexibility of Python?
To not throw unnecessary errors, basically. Like, I don't know. It's to make these rules maybe more general. So, for example, like, this is why they love it or whatever. This is not only true for all I in this length, but rather for all I. And it allows for more flexibility in applying certain functions. So you don't necessarily need things to be of the same length, but rather if you want to apply a general thing and if certain criteria are met, then you don't have to add in all these contingencies necessarily. I mean,
Sure,
I'm not sure. Obviously, I didn't write the length right, but
sure,
you
I
know.
agree. And so let's put this then. No, maybe actually, does it also work for the negative ones?
It
Maybe
does. Well,
even
then you get
this.
a negative. It would then you would start indexing from the end.
Yeah, but and this also applies for negative, I guess. Does it? So can I be also be a negative
Then
integer?
it goes in the opposite direction or something. I'm not 100% sure right now. I'd have to check. But
But
you can definitely do a negative number for these slicing things,
yeah,
but
sure.
it obviously changes the behavior of what you get.
No.
So I don't know if it would be exactly L, but rather be the reverse of L or something. I don't know.
No. Yeah, the thi yeah. I agree that it makes things more flexible and functions more general. What I'm always worried about is scientific precision. Often you want things to be of a specific thing, and the code. I know. So Python tries to give you a versatile code, and I'm also interested in a precise mapping between a scientific concept and a programming entity. And So yeah. Anyway, I think it will be a general thing. Maybe at one point I will be convinced that Python is the future, but I think Python is the future, although I think Julia for scientific computing might be more the future, but this will be rather the future in 20 years or something. So yes, Python is good. It's flexible. But I will think I will not really... I mean, there are many things in MATLAB that you can say the same things that are somewhat weird if you learn it de novo, and at one point you appreciate the value of it. Good. Anything else? Okay, then I also need to stop because we will have our professorium now where we discuss all the exam business.